Become all things to all men, so that I may by all means save some. I do all things for the sake of the gospel, so that I may become a fellow partaker of it. Let us continue in worship this morning. As we continue, we will sing, I'm Forever Grateful. Draw near to you, But you clothe yourself in prayer on your hands and knees. You did not wait for me to cry out to you, but you let me hear your voice calling me, and I'm forever grateful. I'm forever grateful for the cross. I'm forever grateful to you that you came to seek and save the lost. I'm forever grateful to you. I'm forever grateful for the cross. I'm forever grateful to you that you came to seek and save the lost. That you came to seek and save the lost.
At this time, you are invited to turn to one another and greet each other and pass the peace of Christ. Please, pass.
When upon my pillows you're my pampered paw, when you are discouraged thinking all is lost, come so many blessings they them one by one. And it will surprise you what the Lord has done. Count your blessings, name them one by one. Count your blessings, see what God has done. Count your blessings, name them one by one. Count your many blessings, see what God has done. Are you ever burdened with a load of care? Does the cross seem heavy you are called to bear? Count the many blessings every doubt will fly, and you will be singing as the days go by. Count your blessings, take them one by one. Count your blessings, see what God has done. Count your blessings, name them one by one. Count your many blessings, see what God has done. When you look at others with their lands and gold, think that Christ has promised you his wealth on hold. Count your many blessings that he cannot buy, your reward in heaven or your home on high. Count your blessings, name them one by one. Count your blessings, see what God has done. Count your blessings, name them one by one. Count so many blessings, see what God has done. So amid the conflict, whether great or small, do not be discouraged, God is over all. Count your many blessings, angels will attend, help and comfort give you to your journey's end. Count your blessings, name them one by one. Count your blessings, see what God has done. Count your blessings, name them one by one. Count your many blessings, see what God has done.
Praise the Lord.
Good morning. It's such a blessing to be here today, isn't it? I'm going to invite our ushers up. Okay. before we take our offering, let us pray. Dear Lord, thank you for bringing us here today so that we can hear your word and that we can worship you. As we take this offering, Lord, take it, bless it, and multiply it. I ask this in your precious name. Amen.
The king of my heart, be the wind inside my head, the anchor in the waves, holy is my song. Let the king of my heart be the fire inside my veins, the echo of my days, holy is my song. You are good, good, oh, you are good, good, oh, you are good, good, oh, you are good, good, oh.
Never gonna let me down. You are good, good, oh, you are good, good, oh, you are good, good, oh, you are good, good, oh.
The king of my heart, be the mountain where I run, the fountain I
moment, I'm going to invite Pastor Tika up, but before, let us pray. Dear Lord, thank you for bringing us all here. Thank you for allowing Pastor Tika to be here. Ask that as you're with her this week preparing what she has to say, that she brings your message and it's not her own. That she speaks your word, and that you use her as an instrument to bring what you want into this world. Please welcome Pastor Tabitha.
It's so good to be here with you this morning. Thank you for having me. My name is Tabitha Gonzalez. I'm originally from Brazil, born and raised until by the age of 27. So cute that I couldn't say no, and we got married by the end of 2007 and moved here in the U.S. to serve the Global Church, the Global Ministry Center. My husband was invited to serve Global NYI. And throughout this year, I have learned to love the culture. I have learned the language. Also got to learn another culture, which is Hispanic culture. We serve mainly as co-pastors in the Hispanic congregation of Central Church, while I also get to serve as district missionary at the Kansas City Conference. So thank you for having me. One of the greatest joys for me being with your Sunday school group is to be able to visit churches, which co-pastoring a congregation sometimes is a struggle, and I'm really, really glad for Pastor Mike's invitation. And Justin, thank you so much for having me today. I was able to ask for a break in my local church, and they said, well, you don't need it this Sunday. Okay, good. You will not always need it. That felt good. But I get to be here with you sharing God's word. Also here with me is Merari Garcia. She is preparing her paperwork to come and serve as an executive assistant for missions in the Kansas City District. So we are praying, and if you could join us in prayer for all the paperwork information that is needed. Merari is from Mexico, has lived here for a couple of years now already, serving their program, and the Lord has gifted her with design and arts that is amazing. And actually, Merari was the one who helped us this past two district assemblies with graphics and design, especially for our students. So, thank you, Merari, for joining us. Please also pray for her. She's staying in our house these days, and I felt so terrible that I cannot be a great host for us because our life is crazy between my two boys. Lucas, the eldest, is almost 12. Last night was breakaway. Do you guys have young people going to breakaway from this church? Oh, it's an all-nighter event for kids, and it was the first time my kids spent all the night having fun. I'm getting adjusted to be a mom of a teenager at home. And Jeremias is our second son. Jeremias is Jeremiah in Spanish. He is 8 years old. And God has blessed us. As I said, I served. It is okay if I borrow one of the stands for. Oh, I want to be closer. Would that be okay if I move it? All right, thank you. I'm sorry, I'm Brazilian. I like warmth of people and being close to people, so sorry to disrupt the pulpit setup, which is great. Thank you, David, for leading us into worship. It was a blessing. I bring greetings from Reverend Kyle Paul. As you may have heard, since Dr. Eddie Eastep has stepped out and moved and accepted the call to serve in South Central Ohio, we have been in position in the district office. And this past Monday, it was the first day of work for Kyle Cole, who is our district superintendent, and I bring greetings from him, and I also bring greetings from Reverend Wayne Nelson. I think he will be here with you guys next week, so I'm glad I'm preparing the way for him. I love to serve with the group that we have in the Kansas City District. And this morning, as Pastor Mike was sharing a little bit about this church, he told me that you guys are a very, very missional church. And he asked me to bring a message or a passage that could speak about God's mission and his will for us in that area. And hey, I'm a district missionary, so I said, okay, I guess that one will be fitting right in with what God is doing in my life and ministry. And as a district missionary, people often ask, what do you do in the district? I mean, I know what a missionary is, you know. It's obvious that I'm somewhat cross-cultural here, you know, by the accent you can tell. If by the face you cannot tell, by the accent you for sure know that I'm not from here. And actually, that was one of my questions when Dr. Eddie Stark invited me 4 years ago to serve as a district missionary. And as a district missionary, the vision is to provide leadership and to serve our local congregations in two missional areas that are really strong in our district. The first one is multicultural ministries. Do you have, now, the Kansas City District has about 110 churches, like registered 109, but 110. I don't want to pop quiz you, but do you have any idea of how many multicultural congregations we have in the Kansas City District? And that would include, just FYI to make it easier, that would include organized churches, that would also include multi-congregational churches that has a congregation that speaks a different language serving alongside the ministry community. Any guess? Are you from somewhere? All the Nazarenes, yes. Church of the Nazarenes. 30, you nailed it. I think I gave a hint as we shared this morning. We had 30 congregations in our district. Now, that I didn't say. How many languages do worship God as a Kansas City district every Sunday? Five? Okay, that's a good number. 18? That's an awesome number. Anyone else? We have an average of 10 languages that we every Sunday worship God. So we have English, we have Spanish, we have Kayamalenge, which is a Congolese congregation, and they also use Swahili, and a little bit of French as well. I don't know why we don't count the French. I think Kayamalenge and Swahili was the official ones. We also have Chinese, we have Korean, we have Pompeian, which is a Micronesian, we have Turkish, which is also Micronesian. We have Portuguese, and where is the 10th? Huh? Samoan, thank you. Who helped me with that? Thank you, Samoan. How did I forget Samoan, especially here in this congregation? That was just like a tricky question. I was testing you guys. Okay, good accent here, but... yes, we have 10 languages in Samoa. I needed to learn of them. And I know you guys have a Samoa congregation here. And it is my privilege to walk alongside the leaders and pastors for those congregations. And I know languages is really important. Communication is really important. I don't speak those 10 languages, but we find a way to communicate and to show that they are also part of the 2 years ago, Dr. Eddie Stepp announced officially the move from a district with a multicultural ministry into becoming a multicultural district. What that means is that we are not just a district that has some multicultural churches here that we work with. It means that those multicultural churches, along with the English-speaking churches, we are one district. We serve the same God, and we have the same mission to make Christ-like disciples in the Jesus Christ. Now, as a district missionary, there is another important mission focus of the district that I get to serve, which is planting churches. Statistics says that the greatest number of newcomers by conversion comes from church plants. It is a fact that church planters bring way more new converts by declaration of faith than what established churches. Now, established churches is a blessing, and God uses in different ways, but the greatest growth by conversion comes from our church plants. Now, we have 18 church plants currently in our district. We are currently working with two more that is coming up, and the past year we organized two congregations so that were kind of all of a part of that list. It is amazing to see in this role that I have, I don't know, I tease Wayne and now Kyle, I used to tease Wade, and saying that I got the best type of job that they could ever give to someone in the Kansas City District. Because I can see from a front row seat, God moves in connecting communities, church planters, and mother churches just to form this church and to bring people and to fulfill God's mission. And that's my role in the Kansas City District. And I have been blessed to serve in that position for 4 years now. And we are looking forward to what God is bringing. And thank you for being one of those churches that has is a multi-congregational church with your Samoan church here. Multicultural churches flourish whenever they have a support of another church or a church that opens their doors for them. As you may know, it's really costly. Buildings, rental, and all those types of things. And our churches, they have this space already. And a lot of our multicultural congregational churches, they meet in either a different space while the English service is going on, or in a different time. And we get to maximize the blessing of what God has given you and given us, which is our buildings. So thank you for being one of those churches, and thank you for the reminder of our 10th language, the Samoan language. As we see God's Word and the narrative of the Bible and the narrative of the God of history, we cannot deny the fact that He had been created to relate with one another. He had been created in a relationship. Whenever we are alone, things don't go well. I was telling the group this morning when I first came to the U.S. how hard it was for me because I didn't have work permission. I couldn't work. We only had one car. I couldn't drive everywhere. And it was so hard for me to stay at home. We got right in the beginning of a winter, which I never expected to suffer that much cold in my life, coming from a tropical country to the U.S., Kansas City, in November, the start of winter. Man, that was so depressing for me. I cannot explain with words how hard that was. Why? Because we were not created to be alone. God created us in His image. And the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit all together formed us from the depths into a relationship with Him and into a relationship with one another. And we can see that through the narrative of the Bible, we see a very relational God, a God who every day group, and we can see that God reaching out to different people in the Bible to make himself known and to establish a relationship with him. He called Abraham and became, and showed how he could guide his life and the promise that he had. Then Abraham has Isaac, Jacob, and with Jacob, we can see that a family and a one-on-one relationship became a people of the 12 tribes. And as they move from Egypt, from the slavery, they are already, they became a nation when they came into the promised land. In all this moment, we can see God searching and reaching out to human race and to us. And when Jesus came, he was a representation, God in person, showing himself in this relationship in a very meaningful way. And he called 12 disciples who he could train to first to be with him and then to send them to go and teach. So God has made us relational people. And it is so interesting to see how our stories intertwine with other people's stories in a way that impacts them and sometimes even change their future and the course of their history. I would like to share with you this morning something that I title Stories of Redemption. And I will start telling you a story about a young girl. We don't know exactly how old she was. Most likely she was between the age of 8 years old to 12, no more than 12. And she used to live in her village with her people, with her mom and her family. And as any child of war, she had to be separated from the family and had struggled. Most likely, we don't know what happened with her family. Most likely they were killed. And then brought as a refugee, almost, as we see many refugees these days. She was brought into a country that she did not know. It was not hers. And once she got there, she was forced into labor to serve in the house of a very well-known lady in this society. And she would perform small works in the households for this lady. Now, this lady was well known in the society for one interesting fact. She had a very well-known husband. Her husband was a military man, really trusted person for the many, many wars that they have led this country's army. And most likely, that man, who was very well known, recognized by their leaders, was the one responsible for the same group of raiders that invited this little girl's village and destroyed it and brought her in. Now, can you imagine the heart of this little girl, a slave serving in a house of the leader who led the army of those who had invaded her? One day, this great man, very strong, recognized man, learned that he had become sick. And the family, as any family would do, they tried doctors, and even when the doctors couldn't do anything, most likely they went to witchcraft. Maybe here in the U.S. that's not very well known, but I had a great-grandfather who learned when he was sick that he would go to the witchcraft to make sure that he had all bases covered. So this man and this family have done everything. Everything. And the response was the same. This is something that we cannot do anything for you. Now, for a household, that is very terrible news. For this girl, perhaps you could think this is God's justice over what had happened in her life and the way that she has to live. If we ended the story here, this would be a very sad story. But I will make a pause and tell you about the life of this man. He was a provider. He was proud of the work and everything that he did for his country and for his family. One thing I love about the U.S. is the respect you guys have for those who have served. I grew up in a military household. My father, he passed away serving when I was 5 years old. And my mom remarried with another military person who served in the army until we were the age of 14-ish, until he moved to serve still the country in the IRS. But as I look at my dad and what he has done for the country and how much he put effort and dedicate himself as his work, I can connect with this man who was a captain of the army of Aaron, receiving the news that he cannot be the strong man provider for his family. And the family was struggling with the news that he would not longer be there, and they did not know how long and how much time they had with him. Two stories. If we end it here, it would be really sad. But there is something that happens with this girl. And it is the fact that although she was in a country that she didn't speak the language, although she was serving in a people that has been really mean to her village, she didn't forget who she was. And we can find that story in the book of 2 Kings, chapter 5. Story of Naaman and a slave girl whose name is not even used in the Bible. This girl, although she was serving in a different people, she didn't forget that, as 1 Peter says, she was a chosen people, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a God's special possession. So she could declare the praises of him who called you out of darkness into his wonderful light. And because she knew the God she served, instead of allowing the bitterness of her heart, the hardships of her life detain and stop her to pointing people to the God who could heal, the God who could save, she did just the opposite. I'm going to read, and I will skip some of the verses, 2 Kings 5, 1-17. We are going to skip a few ones just to make short. Now, Naaman was a commander of the army of the king of Aram, which now is Syria. He was a great man in the sight of his master and highly regarded, because through him, the Lord has given victory to Aram. And he was a valiant soldier, but he had leprosy. This is the New International Reader's Version. It might be a bit different from the screen, but that's okay. Verse 2. Now the band of raiders from Aram had gone out and had taken captive a young girl from Israel, and she served Naaman's wife. She said to her mistress, "If only my master would see the prophet who is in Samaria, he would cure him of his leprosy." Naaman went to his master and told him what the girl from Israel has said. "By all means, go," the king of Aram said. I will send a letter to the king of Israel. So Naaman left, taking with him 10 talents of silver, 6,000 shekels of gold, and 10 sets of clothing. Verse number 9. So Naaman went with his horses and chariots and stopped at the door of Elijah's house. Elijah sent a messenger to say to him, "Go and wash yourself seven times in the Jordan, and your flesh will be restored, and you will be cleansed." Verse 14. So he went down and dipped himself in the Jordan seven times, as the man of God had told him, and his flesh was restored, and he became clean like that of a young boy. Then Naaman and all his attendants went back to the man of God, and he stood before him and said, "Now I know that there is no God in all the world except in Israel. So please accept a gift from your servant." The prophet answered, "As surely as the Lord lives, whom I serve, I will not accept a thing." And even though Naaman urged him, he refused. "If you will not," said Naaman, "please let me, your servants, be giving as much each of a pair of mules can carry, for your servant will never again make burnt offerings and sacrifice to any other god but the Lord." I'm so impacted by the work of a young girl whose name is not even mentioned on the Bible, whom without her, this story, the powerful story that we hear in Sunday schools, and I heard in Sunday school since I was young, of the great captain of the army of what now would be Syria, had been healed by the great man of God, Elijah. But if it wasn't for this girl having a hard time being faithful to who she was, the place where God had allowed her to be, the story of healing would not be possible. It's only because God brought her in the story of this family who did not know God that they became healed and restored. And now a family who didn't serve God and didn't believe God is declaring, "I will not worship any other God than the God of Israel." Brothers and sisters, I will be very honest with you. I don't think any of our names will go in history and be reminded in the history books. That's a fact. But it's still the God of a relationship. He still wants and will use you in mighty ways to change the course of history of those who are desperately needing healing, who desperately need to know the true God. Now, this is a few lessons that I learned from this story. The first one is that no matter where God put us, no matter our history, no matter our limitations, our struggles, we are a chosen people who can declare the good deeds of a great God. Perhaps our lives cannot be extraordinary like Elijah's. For sure, God will use us to show and point people His love. Because you are a chosen people. You are a royal priesthood. voices of Him who have called each one of us from the darkness into His wonderful light. The trajectory of our history has the power of bringing healing to those who are desperately living in the sickness of sin. God desires to use you. The second thing I see is that the need of our enemies, again, is not different from the needs of perhaps our enemies today. We all have those folks that are hard to work with. We all have that family members that are hard to move around. But still there is a great need. There is a need for a healing broken heart. There is a need to break the captivities of sin, of addiction. Broken relationships. There is still a need that God wants us to be used by Him to bring healing. And He is calling us to share His good news and this hope. And I'm sorry, guys. I know how hard you have missed Pastor Mike these days in the service, and you will continue to miss him until Christmas comes. But I hope that through this process you learn that it's not just Pastor Mike who's called to fulfill God's mission. It is you. The role of a pastor is just to enable and encourage you as you go. Do you know why? I will tell you why. I tell people from my congregation, and I tell them, you know what? I am 100% sure that God has not called me to be the preacher where you are, and that's the reason why. I cannot be there while you are there. I cannot be at your work when you're working. I don't know your fellow friends from work. Those you get to serve with endure hardships, endure joyful moments. God put you there. I'm 100% sure God did not call me to share His light and be a witness in your school because I'm not a student there. And I couldn't be now, I'm too old. God put you. And you are called to declare the greatness and the goodness of our God where you are. I am not the pastor, or Pastor Mike will not be the pastor. I'm glad that he's not here. Don't tell him I said that, okay? Pastor Mike is not the voice or the witness that will be a witness for that family member that is really hard to work with. Because God did not make Pastor Mike his brother or his sister or whatever, or uncle or aunt. He made you. God gave you grandkids. Pastor Mike can help love them when they come to church or when he goes to visit, but God has put you there. And God wants to use you. Because the need, where there is a need, is where exactly God has planted you there to serve and to bring healing and to continue the story of the redemptive God that changes lives and changes people. The third thing I learned here is that wherever you are, people are open and willing to hear. I love Barna, an organization, a research organization, Christian research organization, sorry. And recently they launched a study about the new generations and how they perceive the gospel. And it's an interesting thing that what they found is that the new generations that are coming after us, different from everything that we might think, they are called now an open generation. This is a generation different from ours that we would go and, you know, try to prove that Jesus really lived and that he was really the Son of God. This generation that is coming after us already believe and already recognize that Jesus was a figure and a person in the history of humanity that really lived among us. So they do believe there is a Jesus. Now, the one thing and the question that they are not able to answer these days is that, is indeed God good? Now, I don't know about me, but I learned about God's goodness when he intervened in my life and showed that he could forgive me and restore him and give me a good purpose. What is a challenge for us today is the way that we need to adjust our ways of doing evangelism as we did before, because this generation will not be easily attracted to a church, and, you know, although they will come if we invite, they will come if we extend an invitation, but the way that they see the goodness of God is through our relationships. It's as we walk alongside them, we make mistakes, and we show a God of forgiveness when we say, I'm sorry, I did something wrong, and I don't think that's what God wants me to do. So I'm sorry for the way that I spoke to you. It is also when we establish relationships of one-on-one, wherever we are, and we share about the great things that God has done one day in our lives. Even when we had hardships, say, God is helping me this way, and this is the God I serve, and he's good. So, we need to change our ways of doing things in order to recognize that the ways of evangelism today is not that different from what it was in Jesus' time, when he actually spent time with people and talked to them. Now, it is good to have a church where we grow together and we learn about God's truth and his word. And we are grateful in the district for Pastor Mike and who he is and the group that serve this church. But the mission has to happen, not just from here. And there is a need. And there is a generation open. And we need to establish relationships that are meaningful. The Apostle Paul in 1 Corinthians 9:22 to 23 that we read this morning, that David read for us, says, I have become all things to all people so that by all possible means I might save some. And I do all this for the sake of the gospel that I may share in its blessing. God will use us to transform lives. Because of this little girl, Neiman was not just healed, but became to a personal faith with God. And can you imagine a general of an army believing in God in a land that didn't believe God? Choosing not to worship other gods and only the God of Israel. We will not always see the impact of what we do in our mission field that God has created us. but I guarantee you that it will last from generations to generations. My dad came to Christ in the military village that we grew up through a ministry that would minister to military folks. My stepdad also came to Christ through a ministry that would minister to military folks. And I can tell you something. My dad and my stepdad, both of them were the first Christians in their household. Especially my stepdad. His dad wasn't his spiritism's religion. He would, like a shaman, would incorporate spirits and get possessed at home. Would bring a lot of suffering for my family, for my aunts and uncles. And man, there was time that we would go visit my family and my grandma would be so mad because my grandfather was possessed. And whenever he was possessed, the bad spirit wouldn't say, "Excuse me, can I come in right now?" Because of people that I don't know the name, and I will never be able to say it, the name, because I wasn't there. Because of their faithfulness of also being a military and ministering the military environment, the history of my family was redeemed. And now I get to be here and serve in the Kansas City District as a district missionary. Whatever you do makes a great impact. And I would like to invite you to ask the Lord, how would you like to use me? Here I am. I don't know the opportunities you will have during the week to minister. But I'm sure that God will bring people who still need. As his witness of his love and his grace. As I conclude, I would like to share with you a video of one pastor who served a group of refugees in Kansas City, Independence area. It's a very, very hard area to minister to, not safe at all. And God is using him to reach out and change the course of history of many immigrants and refugees that come to the Kansas City area. His name is Joel Kodomo. His English might not be easy to understand, so you will need to really pay attention. And I'm sorry we don't have English captioning, we only have Spanish. So let's hear his story.
My name is Nazib Diallo Kodomo, but most of the people they call me Joe because it's hard for any, most of the people to pronounce my my first name. And I am originally from Democratic Republic of Congo. I live in the country about 14 years now. We started the congregation in 2016. I was just here and my family. I was moving from Nebraska. Most are speaking Nyamulenge. Nyamulenge is related to Kinyarwanda and Kirundi language, but the three languages have a similarity. And but we are blessed because we have Kinyamulenge speakers, Kinyarwanda speakers, Kirundi speakers, Swahili speakers, French speakers, and people from, most of them, they come from Congo. But last time we have people from all those three countries. It's Burundi, Tanzania, and Congo, and Rwanda, four countries are attending the church. it's amazing, and if I get to this point, it's not even easy for me to express how appreciative I am. We really appreciate, because the district has helped us in many ways, spiritual way, and also financial way. So if I go back a little bit, this church has is in a neighborhood which is not easy, because we were facing breaks and stealing stuff and whatever. But in all those problems that we're going through, the district were together with us. Each time I call, I give them reports. I saw someone, Pastor Winnie. Each time I call, I saw him here, and they were helping for the paperwork and also financially for everything we did, as they just rebuilt the building, and also when they were brick, they were bricks, so they helped us to be able to renovate and construct and construction for everything which was destroyed. So the district have spent 100% with us for anything we were going through. The vision of this church, it's simple. It's bring people to Christ, Jesus Christ, and preach. We are preaching all over, because I thank God for my, even for my job, I have the time to preach someone. Each time I have met someone, it's an opportunity that God gives to me that I can share word of God. Each chance, each opportunity that I get, so I see lives of people are changing. Some of them, they're not really come and attend my church, but I have this opportunity to go out and talk to someone and preach someone, and I see their lives are changing. Also, African congregation, most of the time, are like cultural, like they have this strong culture, but I'm trying to do integration, like to teach people how to be able to do the church, to do the church, not just like a cultural church in Africa, but church like in America, like where we are. So we're trying to, now we are called, even I start the program, which is just to talk to youth and talk to all the people, tell them the difference between the country and where we are right now. So how we can be on the same page, and we can be able to serve this community better. So we are doing workshops and talk to people and preaching all over and give them seminary how we can be able to serve and be able to grow this congregation. So that's how we're trying to do, teach them the kids, so we can adopt the American culture so it will be easy, because the older people are gone. Young people are coming. They don't know African culture, but we're trying to raise them in this country so they can be able, on our options, they can be able to serve as we teach them.
Thank you for this great message that you hold on past Peter's heart. Thank you for reminding us that while we do have full-time pastors, that it is us that go into the community and minister to you. Everyone that our lives touch. Lord, I ask that as we continue this service and as we go from this place, that your spirit lay on us and travel with us and help people to see. And that's
step down into darkness. Open my eyes, let me see beauty that made this heart adore you. Hope of a life spent with you. Here I am to worship. Here I am to bow down. Here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether loving, altogether learning, altogether wonderful to me. Of all days, oh, so highly exalted, glorious in heaven above. Humbly you came to the earth you created, all full of faith became. Here I am to worship, here I am to bow down, here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. I'll never know how much it costs to see my sin upon that cross. And I'll never know how much it costs to see my sin upon that cross. Here I am to worship, here I am to bow down, here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether loving, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. Here I am to worship, here I am to bow down, here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. Light of the world, you step down into darkness. Open my eyes, let me see.
Thank you again, Pastor, for being here. Thank you, worship team. Fantastic. For those who like to take notes, I would invite you to go out to your calendars and have some announcements. On the 13th of November at 6 p.m., there is a ladies' night at Moya at 1410 Northeast Douglas. 6 p.m., Moya, 1410 Northeast Douglas. Get your suits, get your sammies, and get your caffeinated bag brooches. Are we still on through Alabaster? So Alabaster Sunday is next week, the 17th, so bring your boxes and bring your Alabaster stuff. And if you need a point of contact for that, that's Crystal. Okay. And then our last announcement is November 24th, following the service, in the fellowship hall, we will be having a Thanksgiving potluck, and particularly hanging out the greens. So I believe there's a sign up out in the foyer. There is a sign up out in the foyer, it's just a thing. It is sides, so just sign up for that if you want to bring something. But we will have stuff November 24th, the fall, two Sundays from now. Please join us in the next lesson.
Is God from whom all blessings flow? Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above, ye heavenly host. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen. Thank you for being here this morning. May you go in peace, serving, and reaching out to those in your community for whom Christ died and for whom God has put you in contact. Go in peace. Forever God is faithful, forever God is strong, forever God is with us, forever, forever, forever God is faithful, forever God is strong, forever God is with us, forever.